India feel satisfaction comes largely from self achieving things for the self. Whereas that's not the way most of India thinks or used to think. It's changing very fast also. So I'll share some of that, and I see a lot of hope in that, so I'm going to try and be infectious about it. I'm sorry. I'll start with 2005. This was in Kashmir. We had a big earthquake at that time over there, mostly in Pakistan, but it affected some parts of Pakistan, Kashmir. And when we went over there, we were asked by the administration in Kashmir that they had a peculiar problem because they had the Tangdhar Valley is an area which has about 7,000 houses which had broken. And by December, the snows fall in, and then that whole valley gets completely closed. And this, we were already in late October at that time. And they wanted a solution that how can we build 7,000 temporary shelters for these people in Tangdhar Valley before the snow sets in, which is just 1 month. And So these were the kind of valleys where we went. These were the beautiful people. They used to live in these kind of joint family homes, which got destroyed. And the typical solution used to be that bring in prefabricated structures and make 7,000 buildings, but nobody was being able to confirm that yes, in 1 month we'll be able to make 7,000 prefabricated structures for you so that the people can go through the winter. So what we do normally is go and talk to people and ask them that how would they want to find a solution to this problem that they have. And there are a lot of animated discussions after they realize that we are not here to give them the solution. And then they showed us the kind of buildings that they do, and which we found were highly scientifically built, very beautifully built. These are buildings which are made in wood without any nails, only joineries. And you have proper bracing systems, of course, in many of these buildings. You had this very unique structure, which is the building doesn't anchor into the ground. It's an isolated foundation. So you make a stone plinth, and then you put the entire building on a wooden system above it. And the engineers of the PWD department were not willing to accept that this kind of a building can stand. And we went and took all those engineers and showed them these buildings, that these are the ones that have survived the earthquake, not the ones which were anchored into the ground. And what the local people wanted to do was to build like this. And they had already started doing some building, and the engineers came and stopped them, saying that you can't build like this, this is unsafe. An isolated foundation is basically where the building doesn't anchor inside, and therefore, when there are lateral movements in an earthquake, the energy doesn't come into the building, and therefore the entire building doesn't have to resist the earthquake. So the vibrations travel under the foundation, allowing the top to also move and dissipate the energy. Now, this is a concept that has been engineered by New Zealand and is exported all over the world for multi-story buildings today. We have it here in Kashmir, which PWD wasn't allowing. So we finally convinced them that this makes sense, and a policy was designed. So the policy was that anybody who makes their temporary shelter using whatever materials you have, it has to be minimum 200 square feet, and there will be depots where tin sheets and some wood and cement can be made available, but you have to make your own structure following a certain guideline. And if you do it before the 30th of November, you get 5,000 rupees extra. And so this was a simple guideline that was made as to what they have to be careful about. So they were the non-negotiables. There wasn't any design. And if the engineer was to come and certify that these non-negotiables are there in your structure, then it'll be accepted. So this is the kind of structures that all of them came up with. There was actually a plan to deforest a Deodar jungle to be able to make wood available, but they used most of their own wood, so no deforestation was required. And these are the kind of 7,000 structures that came up in 1 month. I mean, it's an ecstatic feeling when thousands of people get down to a single task and are able to achieve it. So it's also a very healing process, because people suddenly realize that we can do this together. Even though we've gone through a big calamity, but and invariably in temporary shelters become the first step where people do things on their own and start getting the confidence that we can rebuild our lives. So this is something that we have followed in many disasters after that. And this is basically built upon the social capital that communities hold. I want to take a little while to talk about what is the meaning of social capital. Social capital is basically the trust quotient that a group of people have with each other. Not necessarily that they see eye to eye. I want to emphasize this. Unfortunately, today everything is getting divided into we think similarly and therefore we have a trust quotient amongst us. That's not the way social capital is traditionally looked at. Social capital simply means that we have a bonding with each other. We can think completely differently, but we have each other's interest in mind. And therefore, we will stay together and will take decisions together. Now, this is a very evolved way of looking at societies as against the way modern societies are trying to build themselves on, which is invariably on social media, that who thinks like this, therefore we are one group and we have a social capital. It doesn't work like that. Until and unless you're not able to test the ability to, and that's why we have found that invariably in our villages, people have a very evolved system of coming to decisions without hurting each other's egos. Urban areas, in my own society where I live, people are very quick to pass judgment, are very quick to be able to say that this is my opinion. And they don't bother to see that whether it is hurting somebody or not, that somebody can have a different point of view. It's more important to have an opinion than to be sensitive to another person's perspective. And this is something that we are losing very quickly in the way we are urbanizing and the way we are structuring our minds and our way of work. And so I have found so many very interesting ways of very complicated decisions being arrived at by communities without hurting each other. So of course, I'm not talking about, you will say no, but there are a lot of problems also in our communities. That is certainly there, but I'm only talking about where it works. The same way in Kutch after the 2001 earthquake, we did a similar thing. We only gave a simple framework, and within 4 months, 21,000 houses like these came up, which was the temporary shelters. They used their own rubble, their own material that they had. They had depots from where you could get a few tiles, and they could do this. We did a similar thing in the context of land. I think this is applicable probably in Kerala also, because in Bihar after the floods over there, every village had about 5 to 7% of people who didn't have homestead land to build a house. So even if the government was going to provide assistance to build a house, they didn't have land to build it. Now one was, the entire land department, and Bihar being so populated, land is not easily available. The land department was giving these people land in really remote places, places which were not tenable from even a flood perspective, leave alone a social perspective. And so then we made a suggestion that shall we try a system out in 5 villages first as a test case. And the system that we suggested was that let the people find their own land. And any village, their rehabilitation will not start till everybody in that village has their homestead land. So that immediately puts pressure on all those who are landed to find a solution for those who are not who do not have land. And the system will be that you will give a certain amount of money to the landless people to find their own solutions. And those five villages found a solution in 3 days for all their landless. It became a policy, and it was implemented across many villages. There were more than 1 lakh houses that were finally built over there. So I'm saying that it's not enough to say that no, people know how to do things. The policies, the enabling mechanisms have to be designed to help them to be able to move things in the direction that you want things should move in. In the 2001 earthquake, this is the first time this policy was designed, which was called the owner-driven policy. It's now become very popular. It's there all over the world. World Bank carries it to all disaster-affected regions. But this is the first time we worked with the administration to design this policy. So this is basically saying that we are not going to do your construction for you. This is now for permanent houses as well. Every village has to organize themselves. Even cities have to organize themselves to be able to build for themselves. There will be a whole host of enabling mechanisms put in place. I am not going into all the details of the enabling mechanisms today, but they are very critical to an effective ODR policy. It is now a policy which is part of the Disaster Management Authority in Delhi, and it is prescribed to all state disaster management organizations. And it was also then implemented in Nepal, in Bangladesh, in most of the other countries we have been working in. I'll again take you, I put this case study simply because this was a flood where we worked in. This is Bihar that happened in 2008. This was the Kosi floods that he just spoke to you about, how the whole area got flooded. But I'll just take you through an initial study we did in that region as to what kind of housing people built. And one other thing we found regularly all over our rural areas is that they don't complicate their homes. Even if you want a big home, the same unit will be repeated to have a bigger home. But they won't try and put 10 rooms together in 50 different ways, because it complicates the structure so immensely. And that's not the purpose of their life. It's not the purpose of their builders either. Their purpose is to have a simple, workable solution that works. And then you go on and do other things in life, like learn music or dance or do something, follow literature. But you don't complicate something, a good solution that you already have. And that is why traditional housing had a typology. And the typology, if it worked, it was only incrementally changed as time went by. You didn't change the entire design completely. So this is a simple bamboo house. As I said, they have the same kind of unit that repeats. These are wattle and daub structures, basically bamboo buildings. Here is where some brick gets introduced. So they have brick columns, but wattle and daub in between. So we did an analysis of the strengths and weaknesses of the region. And obviously, concrete was the weakness. Bricks and bamboo were their strength. That's what they had traditionally built with for all their lives. Bricks, some of the best bricks of the world are found in this region of the Gangetic Plain. And so we decided to create, and this is a zone 5 earthquake zone. It has floods and it has high winds. So it's a multi-hazard area. So the design approach or the policy approach was that everybody should build 225 square feet of space. There should be a broad material base, because invariably when you have to build so much, and if you focus everything on one or two materials, then you have you're creating disasters around you. No design prescription, but just some non-negotiables will be provided. And the entire policy will be in favor of bamboo. You know, it was a poor state when we went over there. It still is, to some extent. So Nitish Kumar had said that I have 50,000 rupees per house. Can you design something for that? And so that was the challenge with which we took up the whole process. So we said the bamboo house should not be more than 50,000-55,000 so that everybody can build. But if you want to add bricks, it will go up to 70,000. And if you want only an RCC brick house, then you have to shell out a hell of a lot of money to be able to do that. These are the traditional bamboo workers of the area. They're called dabiyas. They make an entire bamboo house with just one knife. And now, that's the again the difference. You know, whenever we think of a solution, we think of adding more tools to our toolkit. Here is a system that says that what can I do with only one tool? And so they are different from the carpenters. This is a whole community of people who just build with one knife. So everything is basically built. What we did was, I'll come to this later, but their whole system works around tying knots. So they have a very sophisticated understanding of knots. So you can have four different tying systems which can put two bamboos to six bamboos together. So that's what we studied. What we added was this bamboo pin. We had a lot of, what we do is normally we go into the area, we identify artisans who have done something different. And so they are the ones we call master artisans. And then we do workshops with them. So there'll be engineers, architects, and these artisans, and we'll do workshops to find solutions. And those become the policy frameworks or guidelines that we ask the government to work with. So this pin was added as the first level of resistance in an earthquake. And then if that, it has to be weaker, it has to be weak, not too strong. So, but if that breaks, then the knots provide the ductility to the material. Bamboo in any case is ductile. Treating bamboo was another issue. I will not go into too much of this. I have a lot of other things to share with you. But basically, we decentralized this as well. You could, this was something we learned from Nepal. And we brought it here. So these are basically pesticide pumps, but we have put the chemicals for treating bamboo into it. And we trained a lot of these guys on bicycles, so they could go and, so for making one house, we needed about 100 bamboos. So for every bamboo, they took 2 rupees, they earned 200 rupees and went to the next house and treated the next person's bamboos. However, we had a technical committee in the government of Bihar. And their concern was that how do you know bamboo is completely treated? Because as you can see, you put this nozzle on one end, you start pumping the chemical into it till it comes out from the other side. So their concern was that if you just do it half and leave it, then only half the bamboo is treated, half is not. And the idea is to be able to push all the glucose that is there in all the cells of the bamboo out from the other side, because glucose is what attracts insects. And so we went back to the people, how will you find a solution to this? So this is very simple. The moment you start putting the chemical from one side and the glucose starts coming out on the other side, there are a lot of flies that come and sit on it. The moment the chemical starts, the flies run away. So they said that that's a simple way to know that now the bamboo is completely treated. So we actually put that into the guidelines, the technical guidelines of the government of Bihar has this two-liner that you can put a tincture so that a color can come out on the other side, but you can also assess that the bamboo is completely treated when all the flies fly away. I have a lot of other things to discuss, so I'll skip the pile foundations and how they found a solution for that. We had a lot of, their system of design, it was basically taken from Madhubani area. Because as he explained, that this is a floodplain. Between the Himalayas and the Ganges is a huge floodplain, and they want everything to flood. They don't want rivers to remain inside their rivers, because all those flood, when it overflows, it brings all the nutrients of the Himalayas onto their farms. And that is why there's a saying that in Bihar, you put one finger and five fingers will sprout. That's the fertility levels of the Bihar soils. So they said if you stop the flooding, we are going to lose out on fertility. So they used to make houses like this, where during the flood, they go into the attic space and they open the, so it's a frame structure, they open the nets, they allow the floods, because the flood waters go up to about 2 feet, 3 feet maximum. They go out, they stay upstairs inside their attic, and they have some chana material and all that, dry food to eat for 2-3 days. Then once the waters go come down, they come down, they put back the nets, put some clay onto it, and they're back to a clean house again. So this is the levels of simplicity with which you decided to live because you wanted something more valuable. So this is the same wattle and daub house. We made demonstrations with the Dabiyas. It's got an attic inside it. So you could build this or you could build this, which is a brick house with wattle and daub, which is trying to become a brick house finally. And you could also build an RCC. This is how the whole construction happened. So you have a plinth made of brick, then the frame. It's a prefabricated structure basically. So it comes up pretty fast. They cement it from the outside, keep it as mud from the inside. And that's a 55,000 rupee house. And when we were there, we trained their whole teams and everything. About 5,000 houses were built. At that time, only 1% of the people, not even 1% of the people, chose to build an RCC. Most of them chose, 60% chose the brick and bamboo option, and about 40% chose to make a bamboo home. So this is the kind of homes that came up. At the end of it, you get a solar light because there was no solar, and there was no electricity in those regions. And you got an eco-sand toilet. The eco-sands didn't work for very long. People had enough water to start flushing things. This is Kutch. Similarly, this is their traditional bhunga structures, which they adapted. So the Meghwals normally build it. So we've worked with the Meghwal community that builds for all the other communities. And we came up with these solutions. I'll come back to this later. In Indonesia, also, these are still structures that are built in the flood zone. So wherever there are surges of water that come in, there's a traditional system of building like this. So along the entire coast in Aceh, in Indonesia, they build like this. The same owner-driven process, so I'm still talking about that people are given money in three stages as they build. And as long as they're following the non-negotiables prescribed, they can build any design they want. So the same thing we tried with the slum housing in Bhuj, where I live. And this was the kind of traditional housing that is there in Kutch, where two brothers will build together. If they have a fight, they'll put a wall in between, otherwise the courtyard is common. So we decided to adopt this. The government was giving 3 lakhs at that time for a house. So the yellow is what the government agreed to support. People put in another 1-1.5 lakhs. We tried to put banks in touch with them, but that was a semi-successful idea, but they managed to find their own money to be able to build the rest. What we did for planning is that we asked everybody to choose your friends and relatives. So everybody made their own clusters. So here you can see that there is the pedestrian movement is separated in the center. The roads are on the outside. And each of these is actually a cluster of 6 to 20 houses. So the road finishes and comes back. There is a vicheni, which is a traditional concept of having all your services behind your house. So it's a very thin place between two homes, but that's where we put all the services. Right now, the biggest problem is that our roads and our services go together. And then we are constantly breaking our roads to repair our services, and the departments don't coordinate. And so a new road within 1 year is an old road. So all the services were put at the back. And then each of these clusters forms their own management system for building their homes. And this is how they build. So these are the kind of homes they built. This is a cluster. So some of them put a gate in front of their cluster. This is, I'll take a little time here to talk to you about these shallow dome structures. This is something we learned from traditional artisans in Muzaffarnagar. If you will probably remember 2015, there was, 14, sorry, there were riots in UP in which a lot of the Muslim communities were thrown out of their traditional villages. So we went and worked with them. We helped about 250 families build homes, separate villages. And what we were shocked to find was that the Muslim artisans over there traditionally built roofs like this. These are basically shallow domes with which are flat so that you can build on top. And this is something that's been coming down from the Mughal times, and about 40 villages over there continue to practice this kind of a roofing system. These are mud blocks, stabilized mud with 5 MPa, this thing, and you put it like this, and from underneath it looks like this. So basically you can have a flat roof system without steel, which is an enormous advantage in climate change perspectives, and you can actually build on top. So what we did was that we demonstrated this in the slums. We had artisans come down from Muzaffarnagar, and they built these structures over here. We also did this, what Katie was talking about, recycling rubble. 2001, after 2001, we have a huge amount of rubble lying in our lakes. So we have put a system in place where you can make blocks out of rubble. This has got basically a little bit of cement, but mainly lime put the blocks together. So any house that agreed to build with recycled blocks and a mud roof, the shallow dome mud roof, was given an incentive of 10,000 rupees. So you are incentivizing to build green. I'll quickly take you to also, this is in Maharashtra, in Ahmednagar. We are doing this housing at the moment. This is about 300 houses for one slum. Here also, 7 clusters have been formed. They have registered themselves as societies, and they are managing the entire construction of their block. It's a ground plus three structure, a ground plus two structure, but they are all in courtyards, which are connected together. At the first floor level, they all connect. And they have a lot of options of how they want to build the interior, in the insides. So this is a single unit. This is if two brothers are living together, you can do it like this. Or you can have, you can live above each other and have an internal staircase. You can have three of the same family living together. You can have three vertically living together, or four like that. So there are many various combinations. And so 30 to 35 to 40 people of one cluster sit down together and decide the designs of their block. So this is what is being built at the moment. It's just, the work has just begun. Here we are using fly ash basically and shallow domes. So the work has just begun. I thought I'll just share it with you. So social capital is not just a way of taking decisions together, but it builds a lot of knowledge and very holistic knowledge without having to rely on major computer systems to know everything around you. And so I'm just going to take you, there are a lot of knowledge systems that we have learned and worked with. I'm just quickly going to take you through all the earthquake technologies that the Himalayas have built and the artisans of that region still practice. Modern India, or modern India basically for earthquakes, puts these RCC bands and vertical rods. That's the only solution that we have. Or you make a frame structure. But our traditional communities had at least 10 to 12 different technologies for dealing with earthquakes in the Himalayas. The Bhunga is a circular structure that came up over here after the 1819 earthquake. A square structure in a lateral movement, the corner breaks and the walls come down and the roof falls. But in a bhunga, it has an arch action. So all the energy is dissipated circularly and it goes out. After the 2001 earthquake, not a single bhunga had broken. So it became a major point of excitement for all structural engineers who came there from all over the world. And then they went on to build thousands of homes like this in rammed earth, basically, because they didn't want to make only with wattle and daub and adobe. So we used to give them steel frameworks, and they used to make their own homes. They also have a lot of resorts now that celebrate the Bhunga. This is Uttarakhand, which has contained reinforcement. They are containing the wall. So they have a wooden piece on the outside and a wooden piece on the inside of the wall. It's in mud mortar, and it is connected in between. Now, this is a very sound system of making sure that the wall doesn't collapse in an earthquake. So we have lots of these things, and the artisans. We had an opportunity to build in the same way with Tibetan nuns in Nepal. These are Tibetan nuns who basically pray for Tibet to become free. So they are along the entire border of Tibet and Nepal. They have formed these nunneries or villages where they sit and pray. They have been for the last 40 years they have been praying that Tibet will again become theirs. So we had the opportunity to work with about 200 of these nuns to help them rebuild their village. And it's a very remote village, there's no road connectivity, so you couldn't get anything from the outside. And they had a principle that we will not cut any trees. Buddhism doesn't allow them to do that. So we brought wire. So basically wire was used in the same way that you contain the walls with. So you can see the wires are put on both sides of the wall and then connected in between. And they play the same function that the wood would have otherwise played. This was tested. We made half-scale models and tested them out. And all the women, the nuns, made these kind of homes. So this was the whole village there. I won't go into this. We have already spoken about the isolated foundation. The bamboo is a tensile, ductile material which allows for earthquakes. We've been recently working in Spiti, where they make three-story rammed earth homes. And they basically rely on a very simple structure. This is a new building that was being built at that time, where the corners are very carefully braced. It's a very regular structure, which is internally with small rooms, so it becomes very solid. So you can see the number of systems, the dhaji walls, many of these, we haven't still gone into the Northeast, where there are still more technologies still to be found. And these are living traditions, so I'm not talking about heritage. These are traditions where artisans are still building like this today. And they know why they are building like this. The other important thing is that this is a process for them. The process is more important than the building. And therefore, the way we segregate the building industry from the social processes or the economy, they don't do that. For them, when you go and invite an artisan to build for you, it's a social relationship you're building with another family, because that person is going to come and live with you for 1 year. So that relationship is very important to them. And so I'll take you through very quickly. I was in Bhutan where early in the morning, 4:30, I had actually gone to find these birds that come from Tibet, the white necked cranes from there. I heard this thumping with a song going on. And so when I went over there, there was a whole group that was helping a widow build her house. So between 4:30 in the morning till 7, they used to help her build her house, and she used to feed them, and then they used to go off on their regular work. So every morning they would come and build, and then go away. And they have a song, so everybody thumps together. In Bhutan, they do everything with a song. So they are cutting fields, they do it with a song. They are digging mud, they do it with a song. So there's enjoyment in anything that is repetitive. And they make amazing buildings over there in Ramdath. This is in Kutch itself. I work with pastoral communities over there. They have a very complicated system of making wells. Wells, in the sense it's an arid area, water is very critical in that place. Unlike you here in Kerala, we have the reverse problem of having many droughts. So a well is very sacred, and the process of making a well is even more sacred. So a family will call an abhat. Abhat is a collective activity for doing something together. The principle is that if I want to call an abhat to make a well, then everybody will come to help. But the important thing is that during the year, if I have had a fight with anybody, then I have to invite that person for the abhat. So you have to, you know, swallow your ego and go and tell that guy that please come. And if the other guy is really angry with you, he'll say, no, I won't come. So then what you do is you send the eldest of your family that please go and invite him. So it happens where the abhat has to happen. Everybody is standing there waiting till this family comes. So then they will go, and the oldest member will go and invite him. And the other person, if he is really angry, he will say, uncle, I'm very sorry, but I can't come. So he will also come back. And then they say that when you send the smallest girl of your house to go and invite uncle that please come for the abhat, the person can't, his heart melts and he can't refuse, and then comes for the abhat. And then the whole abhat begins, and they make these kind of beautiful wells. And this is a yearly activity. They do the same thing with housing as well. So even this is made in mud, where the water is brought for the cattle. And then from up there, the cattle come down and they drink their water and go away. And then they have a communal eating session. So, you know, we found that there were so many of these artisanal methods where they gave a lot of respect to the building community. And so we have been working a lot with them now. But these same artisans, when they come into our cities, this is the way we treat them. And they build all our cities for us. Only 3.6% even pays the minimum wage. 66% does not give them housing on site. 80% does not give drinking water. 74% doesn't give sanitation. No crèches. And their children can never become literal to get out of this cycle. This is India, unfortunately. So what I'm saying is that the construction industry that we all belong to is a highly inhuman industry that we have developed to create beautiful buildings. And compare this with the entire process of building in our villages, where everything is so intertwined into a very nice system. So we have a lot of these artisans. We have formed artisan companies. They build for the cities. I won't go into all this. I think I'm already run out of time. Yes, how much time? 5 minutes? Okay. We've also started, you know, there are every year in India at least two architecture schools come up. But nobody is building any schools for artisans. So we decided we'll start a small school just to start off the entire process. So we have an artisan school where young boys like this do a 1 year, it's a resident program. So all the profits we make, we put into the school. And it's a 1 year program for them, and in which they learn about sustainability, about the value of their own traditional systems of building, and the science behind, a lot of which has been lost over the years. I'll just end with this beautiful example that I saw in North Gujarat. These are rammed earth houses again. It's a tribal community called Gracia Bhils. They have been building the same kind of house for about 500 years now. Now this is the sophistication. So we did a lot of workshops with them on showing them about modern rammed earth construction. And they were shocked at the complexity with which we do rammed earth. And they said that, so we said, would you like to learn this? So he said, no, we are very happy doing the way what we do. And we've done it for 500 years, and we're going to do it for another 100 years. So You know, we think that a lot of these traditions are dead and going. It is true, there is a lot of change that is happening, but we are fortunate to live in a country where you can see all this as living traditions. So we proposed this to the government of Gujarat. We did a whole study for them. Dharmesh was also part of that. And we proposed the traditional building systems. We came across 200 different typologies of making simple two-room homes in Gujarat alone. And these 200, out of which the government got very scared that we will have to approve 200 houses, so we gave them 50, out of which this was one of them. But the surprising part was that none of the engineers were happy to do this. But they agreed for this area, and these were the kind of homes that were built under a government-assisted program now, rammed earth homes in laterite soils. What we always do is respect our artisans at the end of every building process. So while the architects and engineers always find their names labeled on every building, we try and at least do this much. Very quickly, three major structural changes which are going to be required for all of you to remain positive, according to me, about the future. One is that we have to, you've already, as a lot of our earlier speakers, Mohan also spoke about this, decentralization, you're way ahead of the rest of the country. You've done financial devolution. You've actually given panchayats money which is not tied, which means that they can decide on their own plan for their village and use that money the way they want. The rest of the country doesn't do that. That is why a lot of these traditional systems are dying away. You have to bring land. Land is the biggest problem in our country. If you don't bring land out of speculation, they're going to have half of Kerala with empty homes and one third of our population living in slums. That's the situation of our country. It's not that we don't have enough homes. It's just that they're lying empty because they are under speculation. They are being used by the rich to make more money. And that you can't do in India. It's sacrilegious. In India, with the kind of populations we have, land is less. Our earlier speakers showed this to us. You can't put land under speculation. It has to be brought under government control. I might sound like a communist, but that's the fact of the matter. Very recently, Uruguay has done that. Uruguay is an amazing example of having removed all their slums in a short period of 10 years. And they did that through cooperative housing. They gave all their communities free land and no money. They got banks to work with them, to finance them. They've set up more than 2,000 cooperatives. And they don't have any slums anymore. But all that land is, for the next 500 years, been put out of speculation. It's put down in writing. And the third important thing is you have to incentivize local. I mean, that's a very, very big challenge, because the problem today is that organic food that you will grow in your own backyard is more expensive than what you buy in Reliance Mall. And that's the way our economy is structured, that anything that big multinationals produce is highly subsidized, and what you grow on your own or make on your own will always be more expensive. There's the same situation with water. It's the same situation with everything that you buy. If you remove all the subsidies on cement, you are not going to, 90% of the people will stop using cement. They will find local solutions to strengthen their own ways of building. So you actually are talking about a Gandhian economic system where you're promoting craft-based industries as against the market-based economies that we have got into. I don't think we have a solution for that at the moment, not in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request you to stay back on stage to receive the memento from co-earth convener, architect Hassan Nasir.
We were asked to join it, but as you will see here, the walls, some of them, these are made from waste kadapa. So Somewhere between Chennai and Tirupati, there's a Reniguntla district. Once passing through there, I kept seeing these hills a little further.